departments under the three faculties that I told you, you know, the arts, fine arts, and visual arts. We have senior members from all three faculties. So I would request the senior most professor of our university, Professor Chidananda Bhattacharya, to once again formally welcome Dr. Seshadri to our online session. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Devabroto, and a very good morning to our most renowned and most kind of respected guest today, Dr. Seshadri, who doesn't await our introducing him, who is a renowned doctor and a specialist and a scholar and a pedagogue in psychiatry and much besides. Today, Devabroto has already introduced the basic things. I will definitely not be kind of pursuing them. I say good morning to all the auditors in the audience and the kind of our friends and colleagues who may have joined here. Here is a rare, excellent opportunity to hear how, while the battle against COVID-19 is being fought by these very doctors, pathologically and clinically, how topping the battle, the war has to be won. And here, that's why, wherefore, we have had amongst us Professor Seshadri, who will be definitely sensitizing us with regard to what to do, how to take it, and this global affront, this pandemic, which is ever in the ascendant, increasing. So naturally, I would not waste any further time. We are all, you know, very eager to listen up, to know. And thank you, Professor Seshadri, for sparing your time. It's so valuable, I know. You are such a sought-after person, one of the, you know, top kind of consultants and experts in these fields. In the raging kind of bushfire of pandemic, let us, you know, have some promise of water coming from your hand. Thank you very much, sir. You are most welcome. Please carry on.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Chidananda. To begin with, I would like to thank Devabroto Das, who on the communication with Muktida from Jadavpur University actually contacted me first to have a session with the August University, which is located in the house of the great Rabindranath Tagore. I'm also grateful to Snigdha Naskar for sending me the links for today's session very promptly. I want, friends, to actually emphasize on two words in the subject of this session today. The word countering, in the opening phrase, countering COVID, and the word battle in the second phrase, which is the mental battle. But these are two very related words, countering and battle. And I would like to use these two constructs to lay before you certain historical facts and then the emerging or evolving narrative of the COVID, particularly with its impact on mental health. And then I would like to go into sharing with you a very, very critical construct, which is called intolerance of uncertainty, and a related emerging possibility for us, which we call as a social cohesion. I want to predicate all that I wish to say on the whole raging debate on the vaccine politics and the vaccination policy itself. In fact, as I speak, many people are reading an article written by Professor George Thomas, who was the editor of the Indian Journal of Medical Ethics, and Professor Gagandeep Kang from Christian Medical College, Vellore, as well as the ex-principal of the Christian Medical College, which was Dr. Jayaprakash Mulil. And the question that they raised was, you know, actually, who should have been vaccinated first? And the truth is that pandemics of the nature of COVID have a disproportionate impact on the most vulnerable populations. जब हम equity की बात करते हैं, no, equity and equality are not the same issues. In fact, even on equality, if someone, you know, asks this question, what does equality mean? And people often have the tendency to say equality means treating everyone the same. And I often say that is not correct. Equality is not about treating everyone the same. Equality is about recognizing differences. How can you treat everyone the same? You know, the rich, the marginalized, the dispossessed, the migrant worker, the daily wage worker, someone who's lost the job. So there is a redefining that is required for equality in terms of its philosophical underpinnings of equity. And these are ongoing social, civic and political debates as we emerge from the second wave with the not so exciting prospect of the third wave, and God forbid the fourth or the fifth, and till more and more people are vaccinated, we develop herd immunity. The virus and its mutants lose its potency, that never in the our known history, I'm presuming among the many people here, since Devavrata Da introduced Chidananda Da as the senior most, that and I'm presuming that Chidananda Da is 60 plus. I'm myself 65.
Yes.
I'm myself 65 this year. In our lifetime, we have not seen this kind of pandemic. That the previous one, the Spanish influenza, was about 100 years plus ago. And we know 30 to 50 million people died in that pandemic. And of course, the term Spanish flu is a misnomer. It did not originate in Spain. But for some other reasons, that term has stuck there. And what lessons did we learn in terms of public health? That I was talking to a neurologist colleague of mine, a very respected colleague who was senior professor here and also the registrar. And he said that the best public health approach in a situation like this is common sense. The best public health approach is common sense. Last year, when the pandemic started, interestingly, I was in Kolkata for a meeting, and the masks had just about started, but we didn't know, we could not have predicted how this would have gone. And then, you know, March, April, you know that the lockdown started. And in the first wave, the concern was about the elderly with comorbidities, hypertension, diabetes, heart disease, respiratory diseases, and so on. But we know what is happening in the second wave now. Young, healthy adults, even those who have been vaccinated, are succumbing to the illness. The predictions about the third wave are fairly clear. The virus has to find a susceptible host, and the susceptible host will be the unvaccinated, particularly children. And we need to prepare ourselves for the third wave. So this is one part of the preamble that I wanted to share with you. Let's build on this preamble. In the first wave with the lockdown, On a lighter note, people said, ऐसा लगता है कि भारतीयों को कतार में खड़े होने की समझ और तमीज भी है. दैट इंडियंस आफ्टर ऑल नो हाउ टू स्टैंड इन अ क्यू विदाउट पुशिंग एंड शविंग. दैट यू नो वी थॉट दैट दैट वुड नॉट बी पॉसिबल, बट लेविटी अपार्ट, लुक एट द काइंड ऑफ इम्पैक्ट दैट इट हैड ऑन आर इंटरनल एंड आर एक्सटर्नल इकोलॉजी, द स्पेसिस दैट वी ऑक्यूपाई एंड इनहैबिट बोथ इंटरनली इन आर माइंड एज वेल एज एक्सटर्नली, पर्टिकुलरली इन चिल्ड्रंस लाइव्स. लॉस ऑफ रूटीन, लॉस ऑफ प्रेडिक्टेबिलिटी, लॉस ऑफ स्ट्रक्चर, लॉस ऑफ एजुकेशनल स्पेसिस, लॉस ऑफ पेयर इंटरैक्शन, लॉस ऑफ प्ले. नाउ व्हाट डज दिस डू टू पीपल्स लाइव्स व्हेन यू आर यूज्ड टू पर्टिकुलरली एडोलेसेंस एंड यंग एडल्ट्स, द काइंड ऑफ स्टूडेंट्स दैट यू डील विथ इन योर यूनिवर्सिटी, एंड व्हाट हैज हैपेंड टू देयर लाइव्स, व्हाट आर दे एक्सपीरियंसिंग, व्हाट आर दे नेगोशिएटिंग, व्हाट इज द रियलिटी ऑफ, व्हाट आर देयर फ्रस्ट्रेशंस. What about those who were in exit exams with some aspirations of where their lives would go? In fact, someone said jokingly that for many of us, our last foreign travel is over. And if you have not traveled abroad ever, it's very unlikely that you will. Again, this is not intended to be some voice of doom, but I'm just saying that what happens when this kind of radical change takes place in our internal and external ecologies is that we have to recalibrate ourselves. And it is in this context when we speak about the mental battle and how we counter it that I would like to actually introduce you to the concept of intolerance of uncertainty. And I would like to basically are you able to see my window and a PowerPoint yet?
No, sir.
No, all right.
No, sir.
Let me just. Snigdha,
Yes, sir.
when I go to present now, I have minimized my PowerPoint. When I go to present now, do I press entire screen, a window, or a
Entire
tab?
screen. Entire screen.
Okay, when I press the entire screen, I'm seeing the entire screen, but I don't see the PowerPoint.
Sir, please open your PowerPoint now. It will come up automatically.
Okay, I've opened it.
No, sir.
Now is it visible?
No, not now. Not right now.
Okay.
You can share me the file. I will just.
Yes, now it
Now
will be
it is visible.
possible.
Now it is visible.
Right, is
Visible.
this visible?
Yes,
Yes,
sir.
okay. Okay, friends, when we speak about certainty and when we are speaking about the mental battle, if anyone has anxiety or let's say obsessive compulsive, जिसको हम बंगाली में सूची बाई बोलते हैं, सूची बाई. नाउ इट इज वेरी कॉमन टू हैव एन अनरियलिस्टिक नीड फॉर सर्टेनिटी, जहां हमें मालूम है कि यह संभव नहीं है. Now, what happens here is this need for certainty can lead to seeking excessive reassurance. What is available to us in the realm of reality and what is available to us in the realm of possibility? Look at the way that the narratives have changed. The narrative in April, May was, how long will this last? The narrative now is, this is going to last very long, isn't it? The narrative then was, when will this end? The narrative now is, there is really no end to this, isn't it? It is going to go on indefinitely. These narratives are very important because part of the mental battle is because of these internal narratives that we have in our mind. And many of you in Ravindra Bharati, you know, who work, for example, in the Department of Philosophy, therefore know what Socrates said. If you look at the sophists, friends, they thought vertically. They started with certainty and then they built their case on top of it. But this is not what Socrates did. Socrates or Socratic thinking is horizontal. It actually starts with uncertainty and then gradually whittles down possible ideas to arrive at the truth. Now, what is happening in the COVID pandemic and in the large Indian narrative? There's a vast landscape of ideas out there. Aur hamari zimmedari kya hai? Ki mithya kya hai? Aur usko hum discard kar de? What does this mean in terms of the practicalities where children are concerned? The vaccine for children below 18 has not been approved yet. Trials are still going on. In America, the 15 to 18 year olds, they have just started. But no regulatory body will approve the vaccine until the trials are over for children. The best immunity for a child is the mask. So when children have uncertainty, will I get infected? Will Ma and Baba get infected? Will they die? And when these kind of questions plague children, when you say that I have got vaccinated, I may get infected, but I will have milder signs, symptoms. I will still exercise caution and look after my health and wear the mask if I have to go out to the heart to buy bhaji or whatever, or we will do home delivery. So you start with uncertainty and you whittle it down to possible ideas that create a certain holding environment for the people in your circle. Now, this could be your relationship with your students. This could be your conversation with your families. This could be the conversations that you have with your children or with your grandchildren. Ab aate hai, dear philosophers, to Russell. Now, what did Russell say? Russell said that the value of philosophy lies in its uncertainty. What human beings try to do, हर चीज को हम का हम वर्गीकरण करने की हम चेष्टा करते हैं बिकॉज द मोमेंट वी आर एबल टू लेबल पीपल कैटेगराइज पीपल दैट गिव्स अस अ सेंस ऑफ सर्टेनिटी एंड देयरफॉर सिक्योरिटी बट द वैल्यू ऑफ साइंस लाइज इन द सर्टेनिटी इट प्रोवाइड्स ईदर ऑफ अ क्योर और ऑफ गुड वेदर. And if you look at scientific models or mathematical models which predict bad weather, and I'm putting Amphan here because you're in West Bengal and you know that Amphan affected you more. What is the extent to which science predicted this to a certain extent? Was science able to predict ki iski matra kitni hogi? So, part of the combating, therefore, is to avoid trying to think categorically, but understanding that you can reach a certain level of certainty, but not perfect or complete certainty. And that's the value of philosophy. Let me introduce you to Briggs. It's a philosophical introduction to uncertainty and the practice of probability. Dekhi, mental battle kya hai? What is the probability that I will get infected? What is the probability that my entire family will get affected? What is the probability that I will need hospitalization? What is the probability that a bed will be available? What is the probability that oxygen will be available? What is the probability that I will need a ventilator? Now, whether it is the practice of probability, statistics, and modeling of all kinds, if you look at an Aristotelian approach, ye mahashay jo hai, Aristotle, ye kya kehte hai? Ki satya hai, hum use jaan sakte hai, but hamesha nahi. An uncertainty is in our minds, it is not in objects. कभी कभी हम उसकी मात्रा जो है मेजर कर पाते हैं और मेजर करने के अच्छे तरीके हैं और बुरे तरीके भी हैं. सो प्रेडिक्शंस गो रॉन्ग एज वी नो इन द स्टॉक मार्केट इन प्रेडिक्टिंग वेदर इन प्रेडिक्टिंग द स्पीड विथ विच द पैंडेमिक विल स्प्रेड इन प्रेडिक्टिंग हाउ लॉन्ग इट विल टेक फॉर द एंटायर कंट्री टू बी वैक्सीनेटेड. So, if you take an Aristotelian approach to uncertainty, the mental battle automatically comes down to a level where there is even a wisdom of uncertainty. Kurt Spellmeyer says in the Buddhist Review in 2018, when he speaks about the Dharma's true home is neither here nor there, साथियों मुझे कभी कभी आश्चर्य होता है. दी ओल्डेस्ट यूनिवर्सिटीज इन द वर्ल्ड जब नालंदा वगैरह की हम बात करते हैं. सी वी आर नाउ लिविंग इन द जेट प्लेन इरा. मूड किया तो ऑफकोर्स कोविड में तो ट्रेवल हैज कम डाउन, बट लेट्स टेक अ हॉलीडे टू हांगकांग, लेट्स टेक अ हॉलीडे टू सिंगापुर, चलो ऑस्ट्रेलिया चलते हैं, चलो यूरोप का ट्रिप करते हैं. But in the 6th century BC, people never even ventured further than a few miles from their birthplace. And sometimes I am awestruck by the fact that ye jigyasa kya thi ki 2 saal, 3 saal, 6 saal chal ke aana Nalanda, 6 saal, 8 saal wahan padhna, aur fir 6 saal chal ke wapas jana. So the Buddha's search for enlightenment began when he left home. Now modern people travel very easily, as I said. So we may not appreciate the weight of this decision in his time. This liminality grows against the grain. The more uncertain our lives become in response to events beyond our control, the more we want to plant our feet solidly in one place. But what does this mean in terms of risk takers? Racing car chalate hain, mountain climb karte hain, deep sea cave underwater diving. Why do they do this? Do they not know that there is a risk of injury, of fall, of death? Perhaps they do. Do they have a different brain structure? Do they get an endorphin rush? तो सत्य तो यह है दोस्तों, नो मैटर हाउ लॉ अबाइडिंग एंड ट्रैफिक कॉन्शियस यू आर, you're always subject to someone else's error of judgment. And you ask this question to any person, you ask this question of yourself, how far into the future have you made predictions for yourself? You ask this of any student of RBU, they will say, sir, ma'am, I have made plans for the next 3 years. I will complete my bachelor's. I will take a gap year and do some work, and then I'll do my master's. Ma'am, I have made plans for the next 10 years. I will complete my PhD. I have already applied for seed money to start, to begin a startup. But if you ask this question to a stockbroker, he will say 2 minutes, one bad investment, and my entire world can come crashing down. We spoke here of the wisdom of uncertainty. I speak here of uncertainty as knowledge. This is from the Philosophical Transactions of the Royal Society. व्यक्तिगत तौर से हमारी मानसिक अनसर्टेनिटी जो है, the mental battle, और what we perceive as uncertainty, इससे जुड़ी हुई काफी मनोवैज्ञानिक प्रतिक्रियाएं हैं. At the least, they are unhelpful, they are counterproductive, because they are a bias against creativity when we need it most. And at worst, gussa, raag, chidchidapan, jhagda, marpeet. So the presence of scientific uncertainty does not just reveal a lack of knowledge, but is in many cases a mathematical expression of the knowledge that we do have. I was so surprised, my friends, when I did a literature search in preparation for this particular idea of combating COVID and the mental battle, and indeed uncertainty, and this presentation I have used in many forums, that rational argumentation against uncertainty, a taxonomy and treatment of uncertainty for ecology and conservation biology, the language of subjective uncertainty, uncertainty studies in philosophy, economics, and socio-political theory, varieties of uncertainty monitoring, decision making under uncertainty, conceptions of science in an age of uncertainty, managing uncertainty in clinical ethics, decisions under imperfect knowledge. This brings me, friends, to the core question as far as combating is concerned. So this intolerance of uncertainty, jo bhi hamari mansik sthiti hai, our emotional state, our mental state, our mental battle, and its relationship to intolerance of uncertainty, ye kya keval anxiety mein hai? Ya suchi bhai mein hai? Or is it an element of all emotional states and conditions, particularly the mental battle that is the subject of our discussion today? Iska uttar ye hai, that change in intolerance of uncertainty can be observed in many problem areas in our lives. Aur ye keval COVID ka mamla nahi hai. एडमिशन मिलेगा कि नहीं, पास होंगे कि नहीं, पास हो गए तो जॉब इंटरव्यू में सफल होंगे कि नहीं, जॉब मिलेगा तो क्या बॉस क्या अच्छा होगा, बॉस अच्छा है तो क्या प्रमोशन मिलेगी, प्रमोशन मिलेगी तो रिस्पॉन्सिबिलिटी क्या संभाल पाऊंगा, इफ यू आर हेट्रोसेक्सुअल शादी होगी कि नहीं, इफ यू आर एलजीबीटी हाउ डू आई एक्सप्लेन टू माय पेरेंट्स दैट आई हैव अल्टरनेटिव सेक्सुअलिटी, व्हाट इफ दे विल नॉट एक्सेप्ट. यंग पीपल गो थ्रू मेनी ऑफ दीज डिलेमास इन देयर लाइव्स विच आर सेंटर्ड अराउंड the intolerance of uncertainty because they ask questions which may constitute problems areas in their projections for the future, 6 months down the line, 2 years down the line, 10 years down the line. अब कोविड ने तो पूरा गड़बड़ा दिया है सबके जो प्लान्स थे. I am retiring in November. There was already some plan for me to start child mental health services for some very underserved countries, perhaps in sub-Saharan Africa, maybe in Tanzania. That's not going to happen. I will have to look at alternative retirement plans. And while I officially have to retire because of government, central government rules, there is a lot that I have to do. There's a lot I need to do. There is a lot I wish to do. So yes, there is an area of uncertainty for all of us, but we deal with it in a manner where we restructure our appraisal. हम किसी चुनौती का को अवॉइड करते हैं, कोई चुनौती है उससे हम जूझ रहे हैं, झेल रहे हैं, उसकी सोच की प्रक्रिया और मन में जो विश्लेषण है किस तरीके से कर रहे हैं. और जो भी हमारे जीवन में चुनौती है, इफ दैट हैज स्ट्रॉन्ग इमोशनल कॉम्पोनेंट, हम भावुक हो जाते हैं, वी गेट स्ट्रेस्ड आउट, तनाव में हो जाते हैं, सो नहीं पाते हैं, सिगरेट पी रहे हैं, दारू पी रहे हैं, झगड़ा कर रहे हैं, चिड़चिड़ापन आ रहा है, the combating of this situation is called experiential control. All of you who are present here today, what is your dispositional characteristic? Swabhavik taur se aapka default mode jo hai, are you a worrying type? Are you a ritualistic type? Do you keep on thinking? Do you look for safety signals? Also, identification of and exposure to situations that are avoided because they trigger experience of uncertainty. For example, situations that elicit panic sensations. Calls essentially for this idea. If you find anything threatening or upsetting or undesirable, regardless of the actual probability of that event from occurring, there are 4 important things that you can do to combat this battle. Work on the uncertainty issue. How do you work on positive beliefs about worry? How do you change your negative problem orientation? And how do you move from cognitive avoidance to actually doing something, either a discussion or an experiment or organizing a session of the nature that you've done today to really give you new directions? Nai disha, nuton disha. That is because negative problem orientation actually mediates the path from intolerance of uncertainty to worry. Now, what do we mean by negative problem orientation? Look at this. Chahe aap bacche hain ya adult hain, tanav jo hai, stress, it does not affect all children or adults in the same way. Some of us are more reactive. More importantly, some of us react more negatively than others from the stress resulting from much of the uncertainty. Around COVID, lockdown, market will be closed, job ka kya hoga, financial situation kaisa hai, health ke bare mein, health worries. These are all sources of stress. We appraise them in our minds, thinking, cognition. What is the extent of our social support? Basic temperament and issues of predictability. It is a combination of these factors that determine whether your stress will compel you to progress from a feeling and experience of uncertainty to worry. Now, there is a difference between a concern, a worry, an anxiety, a fear, and terror. So to come back to what I said, our uncertainty has got compounded because we lost routine. So the battle needs to be dealt with by establishing a routine. The battle needs to be dealt with is by forming activities that you can really predict. Uncertainty will be reduced if the experience of loss of control is mitigated. How do you re-establish learning contexts, and not just academics, and not just for students, but for yourselves as well? Learning never stops. And this is not just about learning fine arts, or learning literature, or learning philosophy. It's learning a hobby. It's your interest in music. It's your interest in the Bengal School of Art, in Nandan Bose, in Jamini Roy, in Kenduli and Pathir Chapudi, in the Baul and the Darvish Baul traditions, in the Bhatiali traditions, in Fakiri, in Murshidi, in Najrul Gan, in Rubindra Sangeet, in Jatra. How do you reintroduce play in your lives? Aapko yaad hoga, whenever anything bad happens in people's lives, hum kehte na ye Ishwar ki leela thi. The word leela, that if we maintain our playfulness, combating COVID and the mental battle becomes easier. How do you maintain your own relationships with your extended family, your peers? Does Devabrata still have contact with his undergraduate classmates? Does Chidanandada have contact with his schoolmates? Does Snigdha ma'am have contact and still keeps in touch with her PG colleagues who studied with her? And when you do that, part of the mental battle is won. I also want to introduce you to a name, and the name is Rudolf Steiner. Rudolf Steiner was an Austrian philosopher who propounded anthroposophy. Anthroposophy is that branch of philosophy that deals with the optimization of human potential. So there is the anthroposophic practice of medicine. There is the anthroposophic practice of education in the Waldorf schools or Steiner schools. There is residential communities of adults with intellectual disability called Camp Hill communities. So if children cannot go out into the world because of lockdown and the fear of infection, how do you bring the world back into the homes? How do you bring the world back into, how do you create social spaces that, which means there is reality, there is possibility, and there is aspiration and imagination. No human being, no child's imagination or aspiration can ever be stopped, because there is no limit to imagining. Even for a young child to bring a pot with sand and mud and throwing a couple of mustard or coriander seeds and nurturing it and watching it germinate in 2 days is a marvelous experience. Putting two chairs, putting a bed sheet on top of it, a blue filter on the light, nimbu pani bana ke thoda sa Hawaiian music dal ke ye imagine kijiye ki Hawaii ke beach mein samundar ke paar beach ke sand mein baith ke maza kar rahe. And these are the ways in which creatively. So what life do you choose to lead in the reality? Of course, you must contend with the reality. My indication is not that you should not. It is sensible to. But if you keep on delving on possibility, probability, and uncertainty, then the mental battle worsens. Whereas if you rediscover aspiration and imagination and just nurture it, irrespective of outcome, it makes it that much easier. I want to present some final thoughts, and then I would like to open out these sessions, the session for a discussion with you and your thoughts, your questions, your own experience. In the University of Auckland, friends, there is a Center for Informed Futures, and there is a concept called He Orang Hua, social cohesion in the post-COVID world. And they say that social cohesion, if we lose it, then it's very difficult to restore it, especially when there is increased uncertainty and new forms of inequality. Remember, I said pandemics of the nature of COVID have a disproportionate impact on the more vulnerable populations. COVID has ruptured our existing world. So, if we have to respond, it calls for a reset. Reset. In much of our economy, and sustaining and promoting social cohesion will give us an advantage. In this document, they use the word rupture deliberately because it signals an inflection point jahan avsar aur risk dono multiply karti hai. And when a new structural scaffolding is erected based on social cohesion, this becomes the cornerstone of this new scaffolding. Is pe thoda dhyan dijiye, the more vulnerable segments. What is the extent to which your kirana shop, your thela wala, jo tokri mein maach leke bechne ke liye aata hai, not home delivery by high end service providers, bhaji wali jo muri bechne aata hai, what extent do they have a sense of being part of the wider community with trust, belonging, inclusion? So labor market ki participation ki jab hum baat karte hain, and it was in this context that people have been speaking about the vaccination. Of course, health workers, older people with comorbidities needed to be vaccinated, but this 20, 30, 40 year old who form the bulk of the labor market, what about them? Participation, recognition of diversity and legitimacy, including confidence in public institutions. RBU is also a public institution. And the extent to which you extend the outcomes of this discussion that we will have today to protect the interests or to mediate internal conflicts, the mental battle of your student, and how as an institution you respond to them, not only changes their lives, but also provides a scaffolding for you to have a sense of well-being, which addresses the mental battle that you're dealing with. And this is what the UN policy brief also says. They said this in May of last year, including the Lancet Commission on Global Mental Health. So mental battles are on a continuum, mild, time-limited, to severe. And COVID influences people where they are situated on their continuum. So many people have previously coped well, but now less because of multiple stresses. Now, those who previously had few experiences of anxiety and distress may have increased in number or increased in intensity or developed a new problem or a worsening of a pre-existing problem. Therefore, what is this mental battle? Fear of infection, fear of dying, fear of losing family members, fear of losing livelihood, fear of being isolated, fear of being separated, and for women and children, the increased domestic violence and abuse, fear of the future. You know, in 2008, there was an economic crisis, and people often refer to as the deaths of despair. To jo bhi hamari vyavaharik pratikriya hai, negatively sochte hai, madak padarth ka sevan karte hai, they are all linked to loss of hope. Now, as any burden, whether it's economic, whether it is mental, rises, we anticipate ki ye honne wala hai, and therefore, what is required now to combat it is solidarity. Some of the positive observations on solidarity may not endure if you lose hope or become intolerant towards physical distancing measures. But the experience is that all communities have helpful, embedded resources that need to be supported. Ye samay hai, saathiyon, to activate and strengthen local support, especially for marginalized people, and encourage a spirit of community self-help to protect and promote mental well-being. So, itna kehne ke baad, for nearly the 50 of you who are present here, I am also taking the liberty to put on chat some of our links which deal with many of the issues that I have spoken about today. How to handle grief, how to handle trauma. In fact, one of our programs is on YouTube, which is called the COVID series. And we are having a series today at 5:30 in the evening, and I'd invite many of you to. It's a 1.5 hour to 2 hour session on the whole issue of how do you communicate with children, because we are having an increased number of what we call as the COVID orphans. And how do we convey, communicate with them? How do we communicate bad news? How do we handle grief? So all these are mental battles that many of us are contending with. And this is the challenge that we really face. And this is the framework that I wanted to discuss with you to basically internalize isko apne consciousness mein, apne zehen mein utar ke is pe aap thoda manan chintan kare. And my hope or meri aasha ye hai ki it makes a difference in your lives and in the lives of the people that you so ably seek to serve and assist, namely the student community and your extended families and the extended community that you work in. So with that, I come to the end of my presentation, and I am open to questions. There is a raise hand option on the link. You can use the raise hand option, or you can unmute yourself and also if you let's take a 2 minute break and then I will come back to you in 2 minutes, and in the meantime you can put stuff on chat and use the raise hand option.
हेलो हेलो
জয়িতা দি শোনা যাচ্ছে ভালো
বলছি একটা এখন কি আরম্ভ করা যাবে কোশ্চেন সেশন আরম্ভ হয়েছে
তুমি একটু একটু 2 মিনিট পরে আসছো
আচ্ছা
2 মিনিট পরে স্টার্ট করো 1 মিনিট
Well, I'm back after this very brief break, and thank you very much, those of you, Devabrato, Joita, Orita, Pradeep Chandra Das, Ashish Sharma, Subrata Saha, Rakesh Chaudhary, Sohini Dhar, and Shubhir Moitro, who have been very acknowledging of the presentation so far. I'm now open. For issues to be, like I said, you have the raise hands option. I think at the back end, you may probably have permission to unmute also and speak, or if you wish, you can put a question on chat. I see that.
Sir?
Yes, Joita, go ahead.
Yes, sir. First and foremost, I would like to thank you for a very insightful and very thought provoking session. I myself enjoyed and I also was enriched by your lecture. Sir, thank you so much. In fact, this is not a question that I would like to put forward. It's only my observation.
Please go ahead.
Like in the context of uncertainty and the feeling of a trauma in the minds of people in this COVID phase. Mm-hmm. Now, I think we've been living with this COVID for more than 1.5 years.
Correct.
And I can only speak for myself. Myself, when I was in this first phase of the COVID, pandemic, I was very full of panic and I was very scared of this infection or getting infected, myself and my family members. Mm. And but slowly and gradually now, I think after a long time, I did a mental battle. I fought it and I'm now almost okay with it because as of now, I'm COVID positive.
Mm-hmm.
And even then, I think I'm not too much broken by the fact that after I discovered I'm COVID positive. In fact, because this is a habit with everybody. Mm-hmm. The more we stay with the problem, the more we get acclimatized to all its nuances mm-hmm. without getting too panicked about it. So I think each one should rely on one's own resources, mental strength and support from within should come mm-hmm. more than from peers or peer group or from family members, of course, will come. They will come and they're very much sought after. But
a person should rely on one's own resources most, because I, in my case, I was a small kid who is always crying and wanting to come to me. And both he as well as my his father as well as I keep pushing him and showing him off so that he doesn't get infected in any way from me. I'm isolated. I'm in a separate wing of our flat. In fact, the other day I had got this good fortune to read a book by Emma Donoghue. It was titled Room. This book was shortlisted for the Man Booker Prize 2010. And in that book, it's very interesting, and I can very well identify with this woman. She was a lady, though much younger. She was in her teenage when she was abducted and kidnapped by a Taliban and taken to a small room, a cell, where there were no windows and there was only one skylight from where she could see the sky only, nothing else. And then very soon she gave birth by this man to a small baby, and how for 5 years she lived in that small cell with the baby, and how that baby also got used to living in that small cell, very small, tiny cell with the mother, and enjoyed himself, because towards the end he also was made to escape the room. He fled outside, but but very soon we find that he wanted to come back and remain living in that particular cell. He did not want to live outside, because outside was more scary and full of tensions and anxieties to this small boy. He was not used to this outside world. So the inside world is more important and more comfortable to this boy. Shows how much we get acclimatized to the place and the conditions and the circumstances that we live in. So this is it, sir. Thank you.
Joyita di, thank you very much for this very generous sharing on behalf of the entire RBU fraternity. We wish you a speedy and a good recovery, and please take care of yourself. But I want to take up some issues which from the particularly from her own experience of being in another part of the flat, and the nature of let's say the tension in how she's relating with her child till such times that she is RT-PCR negative, or at least the symptoms abate, and also the sharing of the 2010 book. That what I wanted to say, friends, is there is a difference between solitude, being alone, and loneliness. Now, if you look at it from the perspective of those who are incarcerated, either because they have a criminal record and they are jailed, or they are prisoners of war, or they are abducted or kidnapped, or they are in an ICU for long periods of time, or they are in quarantine. You know, so there's a whole range of experiential contexts in which you may be isolated. So there's a difference between isolation, being alone, loneliness, and solitude. Many creative people, writers, artists, like solitude because their creativity is best when many others, on the other hand, like to go out, meet people, be in touch with nature, and they get their inspiration. And both are legitimate. So just because you're alone or in solitude or you're isolated does not necessarily mean you ought to feel lonely. Now, there is something known as ICU-related mental health issues because of the sheer lack of human contact. And in COVID times, the only nurses who come are wearing a PPE suit, and you know, they look like astronauts from outer space. But to relate this, you know, assuming that Joyita Di's child is, whatever the age of the child is, you know, let's say 4 years old or 6 years old or 9 years old, how do you communicate in a simple language to the child why mama is ill? And, you know, you use the germ theory. It's just a question of a couple of days, but allow the child to be in contact through FaceTime or WhatsApp media, WhatsApp video. Excuse me. or through Skype, excuse me, and so that the child has a sense of continued communication and relatedness. And even though the child may not see the mother face to face, but or the child can even speak to the mother and the mother can reply not over the phone, but live. And this is an allergy, by the way, don't get alarmed. So lot of stuff that Jyotadi has spoken about is very, very interesting in terms of how do we respond to the kind of predicament that she is in. I see that Ashish Sharma has raised his hand, and I'll come to you, Ashish. But before that, Bindu Sarkar has put a question on chat. The pandemic has created havoc in the minds of children. How can they cope with their stress? Bindi, if you remember, if you look at what has happened in children's lives, the loss of routine, loss of structure, loss of predictability, loss of control, loss of educational opportunities, loss of peer interaction, loss of social spaces, loss of play. And then they have all these questions, you know, will I get infected? Will Ma Baba get infected? You know, and they're hearing lots of news, and how do you titrate the news? And so before you get into coping with stress, how can you actually reduce the sources of stress itself rather than allowing the stresses to first exercise their impact and then get into the coping situation? So once you provide a routine and a structure, once you get them to make certain decisions, connect them to creative pursuits, with calls to friends and family, with playfulness, with, you know, three things about Ma and Baba that you never knew, story sessions. And in fact, if you look at the YouTube resource that I have sent you, we have put many stories there. While they are not available in Bengali, they are available in English and Hindi. But you can adapt them and use them for children. And these are on different themes, not just themes of loss, but on other themes also, you know, about pro-social things, about friendship. And these are all methodologies that you can use to actually reduce children's stress. So please do have a look at the website that I have put on chat, which is nimhanschildproject.in, as well as please do subscribe to the YouTube channel and pass these links on to your friends and networks. All this material is in public domain and free access, because we don't believe in copyright. We believe in copyleft. So please use it, adapt it, adopt it, send it on. It's intended to alleviate the situation of children all over the country. Ashish ji, your question. Please go ahead, Ashish.
Sir, thank you, sir. Sir, last year, I have read an article in online newspaper about that has been delivered by you, sir. Mm-hmm. The family, I think it will be the family rebond with kids, mm-hmm. where you speak about three kinds of levels, mm-hmm. where you discuss about exercise and etc. Sir, mm-hmm. I have read that article and I was then check details about you, sir. Mm-hmm. Today I am very much thankful to Snigdha Madam and Ravindra Bharti University that she gave me an opportunity to directly virtually meet with you, sir. Sir, in your speech, you have told about the learning never stop. This is true, that sir, learning never stop. It is a continue process, and we learn day by day, each and every day, from apart from our education. But sir, it is almost 1 year and 3 months past, and sir, we are also suffering in this pandemic that is called the second wave.
Right.
And second wave, yes, sir. And day by day, our condition become worsening each and every day, sir. Then, sir, how could we tackle ourselves? As sir, I live single in my home, sir.
Hmm. So, Ashish, first of all, thank you for
welcome, sir.
The following up with the article that you read. Secondly, the issue that you're raising is actually related to my response when you know I was talking about the things that Jyotita Rai had shared.
Okay, sir.
When one lives by oneself, you live alone.
Yes, sir. Single, sir.
That doesn't necessarily mean that you have to be lonely depending on the extent to which you can keep in touch. Let me tell you a couple of things historically, Ashish. You remember when I started this session, I spoke about a historical perspective.
Yes, sir.
50 years ago, if my father had, let's say, to go on a work-related trip to USA, till he came back a month later, there is no way in which I can be in touch with him. There was only something known as trunk call, and that was also very unreliable.
Yes, sir.
Today, you know, with the click of a thing, I can call anyone in Finland, Iceland, England, anywhere in the universe. I can call outer space also.
Yes, sir.
You know, through satellite phone. That so we have reached that kind of. So the idea of social connectedness is exceedingly important, and social connectedness means that make it a habit to be in touch with your family, with your friends from school, from college, from the work situation, so that though you may live alone, you know, you are in touch, and you needn't speak about any heavy duty. It could be about you know, ki aaj ilish maach khaya, ki ruhi khaya, ki papda khaya, ki begon bhaja khaya, ki potol ka sabji khaya, ki luchi aur aludam khaya, aur kisne banaya, kaisa tha, kaun sa. It could be as mundane as that. And that way, man jo hai, ya man mein, agar man vichlit hai, ya man vidambana mein hai, तो वो एक तरह से कंट्रोल में रहता है. सो विच इज आई एम सेइंग लेट अस नॉट कंफ्यूज एंड कॉन्फ्लेट आइसोलेशन विद सॉलिट्यूड विद लोनलीनेस. दीज आर कंप्लीटली डिफरेंट. एंड बीइंग अलोन आइसोलेशन सॉलिट्यूड एंड लोनलीनेस आर नॉट द सेम. यू कैन बी अलोन बट यू आर नॉट लोनली. यू कैन बी इन सॉलिट्यूड बट यू आर नॉट लोनली. यू कैन बी आइसोलेटेड बट यू आर नॉट लोनली. You can be also, but you need not be. That's the point I'm making. That I will come back to two points which Pradeep Chandra Das and Devashish Bandyopadhyay have raised. But before that, I'm going back to a point that Bindi has raised about children and this whole surfing and heavy use of electronic gadgets. That I wanted to say a couple of things on this issue. Dekhi, the digital world and digital learning and concerns about excessive screen time existed even before COVID. This is not a COVID phenomena. Online learning isse pehle bhi tha. There are many very successful, very rich companies who do online learning. I won't name them. You know who I'm talking about. Unka abhi merger wagera hua hai of many millions of dollars. So the point is, online learning cannot be wished away. It is there to stay. Schools are closed. And in order to negotiate the third wave, children need to use the mask and we need to keep super spreading events. If you open out schools, these are super spreading events. That so online learning to chalega. Now, what we are saying is children under the age of 6, 4, 5, 6, total screen time should be about 1.5 to 2 hours, and that too not continuously. 15, 20 minutes, 5, 6 bar. 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, maybe 3, 4 hours or so. And 14, 15, 16, 17, maybe 6 hours, 7 hours of screen time. Wo bhi continuously nahi. Now, what this means is we need between supervised screen time and a family plan. What is the extent to which ma and baba also mobile phone pe hai, laptop pe hai, aur phir aap bachcho ko updesh de rahe ki aap mat karo. So what example are you setting about that? So even if you're working from home and a lot of your work is on the system, you work for 45 minutes, give 15 minutes to your children. Work for 45 minutes, give 15 minutes to your children. So they know that you're interested and you enjoy face-to-face time. And what a family plan means is we are not saying no to surfing or to gadgets. Whether it is gaming, whether it is texting, whether it's online education, whether it's entertainment, or whether it's, God forbid, pornography. Because it's 17-18 years old. कुछ उसमें जिज्ञासा है, वो पता नहीं कमरे में बैठ के क्या देखता है मोबाइल फोन में, किसको मालूम. द आइडिया इज घर की जिम्मेदारियां थोड़ा बहुत, एक्सरसाइज थोड़ा बहुत, रेस्ट एंड रिलैक्सेशन थोड़ा बहुत, मनोरंजन थोड़ा बहुत, ऑनलाइन एजुकेशन थोड़ा बहुत, फ्रेंड्स के साथ, एक्सटेंडेड फैमिली के साथ फोन यूज करके कॉन्टेक्ट में रखना थोड़ा बहुत, और बाकी जो भी कर रहे हैं. तो वो 14-15 साल का किशोर या किशोरी जो 14 घंटे स्क्रीन पे लगे थे, ये फैमिली प्लान बनाने के बाद 5 घंटे इस पे लगे हुए हैं. और लोग कहते हैं अभी भी देखो 5 घंटे. अरे भाई, 15 घंटे से 5 घंटे पे आया है, 60% तो कम हुआ है ना कुछ तो. सो दीज आर ऑल प्रोसेसेस डॉक्टर बिंदी सरकार. दैट सो the issue is a family plan, the issue is supervised time, the issue is to understand that we are in unusual times, all of us, that, and we have to live with this whole digital life and the kind of lockdown and distancing till such times 1 or 2 years later that the pandemic goes down. Let's come to what Pradeep Das says, that for senior citizens and mental health, that parents who are far away and their mental health and how to support them, that, and particularly if you're not staying with your parents, that, and so how tech savvy are your parents? You know, do they have a smartphone? Do they know how to do WhatsApp video? Do you make a routine of? It's a question, Pradeep Das, about. Creating memories. Just as you create memories for your children, can you create memories for your parents? That and let me give you an example. Rajesh, I have noted you raised hand. किसी से भी अगर आप ये पूछें कि आपको बचपन के बारे में क्या याद है, what do you remember about your childhood? You'll remember that which is a memory, and a memory is something that happened very often, or it happened once, but it is unforgettable because it was a horrible thing or it was a very, very good thing. Then. And therefore people say, you know what I remember about my childhood? I remember that in my house we had a 100-year-old bell and it was my job during meal time to ring it. And the family would gather and we would sit and talk. And now at the age of 40, that bell has pride of place in my house. Mere ghar ki shobha hai. You know what I remember about my childhood? Ki mere parivar mein ek sanskriti thi ki har hafte baju wale anath ashram mein jaake kuch hum seva kare. Wahan se social work karne ki prerna mili. BSW kiya, MSW kiya. Aaj 40 saal ki umar mein, main Ravindra Bharati University mein, I did an additional course on fine arts, and then I did B.Ed. also, and I'm a teacher here. That. Do you know what I remember about my childhood? I remember every day thinking to myself, why the hell was I born in this family? What I remember about my childhood is night after night going outside my parents' door to knock on the door to listen whether they were killing each other or not. So what memories do you then create for your parents so that they have a sense of predictability, Pradeep da? So, aisa nahi ki aap do-do ghante baat kare. Lekin din mein, you know, 10 minutes subah, 10 minutes shaam ko, you know, kaise hai, kya ho raha hai, TV mein kya dekha, hamara aisa ye hai, apna khayal rakhiyega, so that they have a sense of continuity. So that's the kind of stuff that we need to keep in mind.
Devashish, thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
Devashish Bandyopadhyay, thank you very much for your affirmative comments. And before I come to
sir Debashish Bandyopadhyay, I have a small question to you, sir. I have an observation. In fact, I all three of my family members, my wife, myself, and my 20-year-old daughter, are presently in a post-COVID situation. That means had recovered from COVID almost 1 month ago.
Right.
But what is troubling me at present, which is a sort of a genesis of a sort of an anxiety disorder that is taking place now, given from the background of your talk that I understand, is that the kind of rhetoric, the kind of narratives that were circulating in the first phase of the COVID is not exactly the kind of rhetoric that we have today in the second phase of COVID.
Right.
And post-COVID clinical complications are increasing. In such a condition, I give you a specific example of what had happened to me. Perhaps it might help you to understand my condition.
Right.
My daughter was found COVID negative after 1 month. And then she suddenly, after 35 or 36 days, her markers, that means clinical markers, pathological markers, had shoot up. Mm-hmm. With the D-dimer increasing and the hsCRP increasing. Now, big middle class, a little educated people, we are used to reading a lot of literature from Lancet and other things, other texts, which tell us that these increase in markers in a post-COVID condition might lead to dangerous consequences. So I immediately consulted a number of doctors. One of my family members is a doctor, but they assuaged my grievances, assuaged my anxiety, saying that these particular changes are mild. But still, whenever my own D-dimer after 35 days increase shoot up to 1,074. Uh-oh. But these pathological tests and these particular literary circulations or discursive circulations are creating an anxiety disorder that different doctors or different clinical practitioners cannot completely assuage in me. In spite of the peer reviews, in spite of so many friends I'm contacting with who are in medical practices and other things.
Right.
If you please address this issue.
If we go back to part of the presentation that I made about mathematical predictions or the use of markers you know, as a prediction in diagnostic processes, the precision to which they are suggestive, indicative, confirmatory, they really vary. And I think if you relate this to the whole mental stress issue, you see, BP can be measured, blood sugar can be measured, pain cannot be measured. If I tell you I have a pain, I may describe it as mild, I may describe it as severe and incapacitating, but there is no objective measure of pain. Also, two people with exactly the same injury may have different kinds of pain tolerance. So how individual systems respond to either an illness or a post-viral situations vary. That. So from a mathematical perspective, what we call as the outliers, that the logical explanation for certain medical states, if you look at the Gaussian curve, maybe to the extent of 60 to 70%, people may fall within the logic of explanation. which we derive from science, but there will be the two outliers, 10% at either end or 15% at either end, who will defy logic or who will defy the principles of science or any objective measurement. And that's where I think, rather than Debuda, rather than what we call as evidence-based practice, we often speak about patient-based evidence. This evidence-based practice or evidence-based research is, you know, all the Lancet stuff that you're talking about, and meta-analysis and effect size, and but there is patient-based evidence also that ultimately it's about the individual child, the individual patient, and our monitoring of that person's condition, and looking at this from the perspective of judicious, you know, kind of treatment. I would also draw your attention, Debuda, to a YouTube presentation of a classmate of mine from my medical school. I studied in Maulana Azad Medical College in Delhi. And I have a friend called Dr. Matthew Verghese. And there was there's a YouTube presentation of which has been watched by almost a million people. And I'm taking the liberty to put on chat one of the links of his. But he explains all this very... He's an orthopedic surgeon, but he's a wonderful classmate of mine. And this is one link, but if you go to the link, you'll find many other links. These are short, just 19 minutes, 20 minutes. With Devuda, he will be explaining exactly the point and giving you a framework which will in some ways address the very important point that you have raised about the complexities of the narrative and how you make sense of this. Ye gutthi jo hai, isko kaise suljhaye. So thank you very much, Debuda, again for this very generous sharing from a very personal perspective.
Thank you, Professor Sheshadri, for the link and your illuminating talk as well. Right. I want to share something else with you.
Please go ahead.
In 1917, I did a workshop with Mahendra Sharma, your colleague from the clinical psychology department, on mindfulness-based meditation practice, and contacted a sort of a collaboration with my former university. I have come here newly. So I am into practicing mindfulness-based well-being meditational things. In spite of that, this particular anxiety disorder has suddenly got me. That actually created a sort of a what do you call it, a worry in me. That's why I shared this particular issue with you. Okay, because this was unprecedented. I have been through a lot of anxieties, but nothing troubled me so much as these particular stresses. Perhaps it might be due to the fact that it was my family which is involved in this, and I'm too much thinking and too much responsible to my family, to my affections for my daughter and other things, perhaps. Okay, yeah. Thank you so much, Professor Sheshadri.
Thank you, Devuda. And Pradeep Das, just to come back to the point that you raised, that about the visual problems that your parents have and they don't have a smartphone, in which case just an ordinary phone call will do, just an ordinary phone call, just so that they have the comfort of continued of contact and continuity. Paula Sengupta has raised a very interesting issue that the pandemic has been particularly difficult for working women. And as a result of this, roles have been drastically altered from a work-home balance to 24/7 homemakers. Everyone at home, the demands of the household have increased manifold, making it hard to keep any kind of balance. And as a result of this, the only time we are spending on professional pursuits is the leftover time when we are honestly not at our best. And sometimes I feel we are doing an injustice to ourselves and What's your advice on dealing with this? That it's a very, very important issue, Pauladi. And both from a gender perspective, but I would like to really look at this from the issue of time management. And I think sometimes in the debate or the tension or the balance between quantity and quality, our focus tends to get on quantity, that you know, the amount of time or not enough time, instead of on quality. And therefore, to pursue one's personal interests and hobbies or maintain connection with friends, if one were to shift the paradigm from quantity to quality, to say that even if it is 15 minutes or 10 minutes, I will focus on the quality of that experience and not that the time was not enough. Not to suggest that the desire to have more time is not legitimate. That's not my point. But my point is judicious time management, by which you keep quality going and draw solace and joyousness and affirmation from the quality, so that you don't do injustice to yourselves. You know, your interest in music, your interest in art, your interest in journal writing, your interest in meditative practices, your interest in trying new recipes, your interest in remaining in contact with your friends and their lives, and your interest in literature, as the case may be. And so that's the way that I would really look at it, Pauladi. Rakesh ji, aapka hand raised tha, would you want to say anything?
Thank you, sir, for your wonderful presentation. My specific question to you is that it is all related with our mental health issue.
Right.
And as who described that, mental health is subjective well-being of an individual, which right. is very much related with someone's self-efficacy, autonomy, competence, and many things. My right. specific question is to you that there is a word that is called self-actualizations of one's emotional potential, which is very much related with one's mental health issues, his mood. Can you give some ideas, concrete examples, how we can develop our emotional potential in this crisis situation? What opportunity define the term emotional potential and self-actualization of that?
Right. One of the issues that we often speak about in the context of self-actualization is actually called Maslow's hierarchy of needs. And Abraham Maslow, who actually spoke about the hierarchy of these needs, when you know, he spoke about physiological needs, which are, he called them as basic needs and safety needs. So the basic needs are basically physiological needs and safety needs. The bottom of the pyramid is food, water, warmth, rest, and safety needs being security and safety. Then he came to psychological needs, first belongingness and love, which is intimate relationship and friends, and then esteem needs, which is prestige and the feeling of accomplishment. And then he came to self-fulfillment needs. And that's where self-actualization or achieving one's full potential, including creative activities, that now, so if you look at self-actualization and and related to emotional issues, which is the highest levels. And Maslow sometimes called it as peak experiences, that, you know, it sort of describes the level to accomplish everything that one can and become the most that one can. Now, you may, for example, have a strong desire to become an ideal parent, or in someone else's desire may be expressed academically, or in others it may be expressed creatively, as in paintings or pictures or innovations. That so somebody, if I'm not mistaken, I think it was Rousseau who said that essence is defined by activity. So the essence of the emotional aspect of self-actualization is defined by the activity, which is creative activity, or how you nurture a relationship and become a friend to your child, so that you then go into a level of transcendence where a person is motivated by values which transcend beyond the personal self. Now, some of you may be religious, some of you may be believers, some not, some of you are agnostic, some atheist perhaps. And what Maslow often said is, when you speak about mystical experiences or certain experiences with nature or aesthetic experiences or sexual experiences or service to others or the pursuit of science or of religious faith, that the experience that you get, for example, of a beautiful sunset or just the smell of the first rain on mud, that Dr. Rajesh, it's as simple as that. So I'm giving you a framework of how the simple operationalization of emotional self-actualization occurs by the role that you play, or by a creative or an aesthetic pursuit. So that would be my response, Dr. Rajesh.
Is not it very much related with our sensory acuity, how effectively we use our sense organ, the ability to use our sense organ to perceive anything? And is there any relation between that?
Emotional self-actualization is related to how you use your sense organ, but not entirely defined by it. It is also your internal thoughts. It is also mystical or meditative experiences, which are more internal than sensory. It could be about just the sheer joy that you get out of playing or observing a child. And you may see, in as much as you observe a child, it is a visual experience. So yes, sensory experiences are could be part of an emotional self-actualization, but not entirely defined by it. That's the point I'm making.
And also related with our reflective thinking, reflective abstraction.
You're absolutely right. That. So, thank you very much, Paula, for your comment there. And I'll just take these last two interventions and I'll have to close the session, Devabrutu Das, just to let you know that I have
I was about to intervene. Yes. Yeah. Two more questions.
I have multiple responsibilities here. You know that
I am
the dean. I have several papers to sign and I have another training program going on.
We understand perfectly, sir. Thank you.
Dr. Chaudhary, I cannot write. I don't know the techniques of writing. I congratulate you. It has been a great learning experience from my side. Thank you very much. Okay, thank you.
So Snigdhadi says, in the lockdown phase, I feel my solitude is being ruptured completely with the Hangama family. As a result of that, I'm starting to feel stressed with workless business and perhaps becoming rude and sometimes behaving very selfishly towards other family members. And what is your advice? That Snigdhadi, it's a question of a joint decision, and once you jointly decide and you request for some private time, to say, I'm not asking for 6 hours of private time, I'm asking for half an hour of undisturbed private time and solitude for me to and once you put that into motion, then despite your raucous, joyous and fun Hangama family, you'll still be able to protect that time and carry out your pursuits and maybe try different hairstyles or different shampoos to wash your hair. And as Jyoti says, in this pandemic situation, will it be wrong to pressurize children to study because there's always an underlying fear that the child whiles away his or time doing nothing constructive? And our take on this, like I said earlier, it's a question of dividing the day into a judicious, it's not study all the time, because a child is not equal to a student. Because if a child is equal to a student, then a good student is equal to a good child, and a bad student is equal to a bad child. A child is a son, a daughter, a grandchild, a nephew, a niece, a sister, a brother, a friend, a Bengali. He likes Ruhi better than Pabda. He likes Kekra. He's never eaten Kochua in his life because tortoises are not that easily available. And he's a music lover. And he likes Hindi films better. He likes Bollywood films better than Tollywood films. And a student. So that's the way that one would really look at. So it's a judicial, it's a family plan that one needs to keep in mind to really work on this issue. That and with that and my ever increasing allergy, so that I can go and take my anti allergy tablet now, I hand over to Devabrata to close the session, and I wish you all good health and good safety, be in good cheer. And
so I think Professor Soma Basu has raised a question in the chat box. If you treat it as the last question, that will be better. Great.
Yes, it's a very important issue, Soma, how to cope with the sorrow and grief from the demise of the husband of my first cousin less than a month ago. She's staying alone, and the days of togetherness are haunting me with her. And, you know, we grew up together. Loss and grief are difficult issues to deal with, and also the circumstances of the loss. You know, logical life narratives, man is 90 years old, invested well, saved well, he has children, grandchildren, great-grandchildren, and he's slowly fading away, and of the extended family of 135 people, 60 managed to gather, and he slowly fades away. That's a logical story. 7-year-old child is walking back from school, laughing, jumping, and some irresponsible electric line man has left a live wire open and the child's hand touches it and he gets electrocuted and dies. That's not a logical story, certainly not for the parents. So, Somadhi, grief is the extent to which you are with the person who has suffered the loss. And be there for her immediate needs so that she doesn't have to struggle. Allow her to decide the extent to which she needs her solitude or the extent to which she...
Yes, I know. But still now, I cannot able to come out of the grief, and I am suffering equally with her. She is staying all alone in her house. Usually she used to stay with her husband, but for the last 22 or 24 days she has been alone. And in this situation, any of the family members could not go up to her, could not reach her. And the grief she is going through, I cannot tolerate anymore. So this is just getting on with my nerves, and my family members are very much worried about me. But nothing can be done. Okay, thank you so much. Thank you.
Somadhi, you grieve because you feel because you're sensitive, and you're sensitive because you're human. And what you're experiencing is a normal reaction to an abnormal situation. Your grief and your cousin's grief and the loss they experience is not the problem. It is not the pathology. It is a normal reaction to a completely abnormal situation.
Especially when we know, both of us, all of us know that this will not go away.
Yeah.
This sense of sorrow will never go away.
Yeah.
Only last December we met in a family get together. And now he is no more.
Yes.
Okay.
And it is how we hold on to basically the times that we have shared with... and all I can say, Sumadhi, is that, you know, I'm reminded exactly 20 years ago in the same month of May when I lost my father. Of course, we're not talking about COVID times. And I remember he was on a ventilator, so he could not speak. So he asked for a pen and he writes the last sentence he wrote before he died. And he wrote, Sumadhi, we are all angels with one broken wing, and the only way we can fly is by holding each other. We are all angels with one broken wing, and the only way we can fly is by holding each other.
Right. Nice words.
You are doing wonderfully for your cousin, and I salute you for your sensitivity and the fact that you feel so much for another person. That, and in the balance of it, that's what truly makes you a human being, and a thinking and a feeling human being. I would also like you to draw your attention to the COVID series that we are doing, one of which is scheduled for this evening at 5:30, and the next one, which is on grief and loss. And please do watch it, and you know, it will give you some ideas there. Over to you, Devavrutuda.
Yeah, Kuntaladi, are you here with us still, Kuntaladi?
আচ্ছা দেবু আমি তাহলে একটু কনগ্রাচুলেশন জানিয়ে দিই ওনাকে
হ্যাঁ আমি তারকদা আপনাকে বলছি কুন্তলাদি আছেন আচ্ছা তার আমি তারকদাকেই বলছি তারকদা ইজ দ্য ডিন অফ আওয়ার আর্টস ফ্যাকাল্টি অফ আওয়ার ইউনিভার্সিটি আই উড রিকোয়েস্ট তারকদা টু গিভ আ ফর্মাল ভোট অফ থ্যাঙ্কস ইন ওয়ান অর টু সেন্টেন্সেস এন্ড দেন উই উইল এন্ড ইট আপ ইয়েস
থ্যাঙ্ক ইউ
থ্যাঙ্ক ইউ প্রফেসর শেখর শেষাদ্রি for your lecture, which is as clear as water. I have been listening all the issues and interactions what have been done. You have particularly exactly mentioned the greatest impact on children, adolescents, in this pandemic situation. And I add with one thing that the education in general, from primary to university, have been greatly, badly affected by this pandemic situation. Sir, I would like to add these things. Other institutions have been working any other way, but the educational institutions have been paralyzed for last 1.5 years. And you have mentioned the uncertainty of future plans and loss of hopes, and uncertainty has been educational uncertainty, job uncertainty, panic situations. You have mentioned all these things and given remedies to how to set our mind, how to participate in social and creative activities. So all these you have mentioned, you have given an interactions from my colleagues. You have very politely, very clearly, you have mentioned, and you have mentioned name. Dr. Bhargis, he is our doctor. If he is in Vellore, in orthopedic department, he is our family doctor. When you go to Vellore for orthopedic, for myself and my wife, we meet him. He's a very good fellow. If that very Bhargis is your friend. Anyway, and I must congratulate to the Arbuta, particularly Devabroto Das, and the members, Snigdha Noshkar, and all other members of the Arbuta, who have organized this very wanted situation, the situation we have been facing every day. We have been losing near there and near once every day, we are getting a panic. So in this situation, this kind of lecture, they have been organized. And so from my part, I obviously grateful and congratulate to you all. And also, last but not the least, the participation. Those who participated, nearly 47-8% have participated. Totally, I have heard. And they have questions. They have given their opinions. All these are making very much lively the total situation for 2 hours. We don't know how did you pass these 2 hours with the 20 lectures from Professor Sajjee. Congratulate everyone for the joint effort. We hope we would meet again. We try to combat. The last word I would like to say that world was never bed of roses since its inception. All the world from its inception, when the human civilization starts, they have been through some sort of hurdles. And now, and being have passed all these hurdles, they're still living and working and doing their activities. And I think this pandemic also will one day will leave us, and we will again triumph over this disastrous crisis. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Adhikari, and thank you once again, Dr. Seshadri. Thank you. Namaskar. We end the session here today. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.